They found a way back.
What's up, guys? Lifting here. It's that time of year, the time where people come together, the time where we celebrate something bigger than any of us, where families gather and play Path of Exile. Build number one on the list is by Enki, and it probably doesn't come as a big surprise to anyone who has been reading the patch notes as to why I feature this build. Arc is a very strong skill by itself, or as a trigger skill. The weakest part of the skill was that the range of which the arcs previously could chain in between one another could feel slightly restricted. However, that particular aspect of the skill has been buffed to 35 up from 25 in 3.9 Metamorph, greatly increasing the range of which you can chain. This is the type of build for you guys who roleplay a wizard in real life and have at least one character in-game with the word pew added to it in some form or another. It's also very good for new players and of course works great on a budget. The build uses the powerful lightning skill Arc, which works by firing a lightning bolt from your penis, and then depending on the level of the skill, it will chain a certain amount of times towards other monsters. The chain effect and the sound effect is incredibly satisfying. The guide is exceptionally well written and ensures you will get a nice transition into the league even if you are a beginner or a veteran to the game. As the elementalist, you'll be able to leech, become immune to reflected elemental damage, and get extra effect of your shock debuff, leading to
more damage.
It is entirely possible to play this build as a solo self-bound character and rely primarily on rare gear. But if you have access to trade, then items such as the Impulse's Broken Heart, Essence Worm, Mind of the Council, and Doriani's Catalyst are all good and viable choices to pick from. However, there are plenty of alternatives too, depending on your budget and preference. Guys, when I started out doing YouTube, I told myself, I want to reach 100,000 subscribers. That was my goal. I didn't care how I got it. I just wanted 100,000 subscribers. I am very, very close right now. Do me a favor, everyone. If you aren't subscribed, hit that subscribe button. Help me reach that goal that I've been working for so long, and you'll make me very happy. The true Christmas miracle. Thank you very much. Build number two is a Skeleton Summoner by Gassy. This is for the aspiring summoners out there. With this, you'll be able to choose between two different variants of the build, one that revolves around the melee skeleton warriors, or one that instead spawns ranged spellcasting skeleton mages. Both setups use the summon skeleton ability, but the mage variant implements the Dead Reckoning, and through this converts your regular skeleton warriors into skeleton mages. To further add to this, it is also possible to incorporate the Vol Summon Skeletons ability. This is a very satisfying skill to use, as it practically raises a skeleton army under your control in just one click. The skill is very powerful in two different ways. First of all, by spawning a huge amount of minions in such a short amount of time, it greatly increases your burst DPS, something that is especially useful against bosses, and considering that bosses in general have been buffed in 3.9, it might prove especially useful this league. The other part is that enemies have a tendency to attack your minions instead of you, and with this many potential targets, this indirectly makes you significantly more tanky. If that wasn't enough to entice your curiosity and you want even more minions to command, then don't worry, the build also features the powerful Tsukuhama Vanguard Spectres, which summons totems that scorch and burn your enemies. And these are especially powerful against bosses, as the damage accumulates for each second the scorching ray is affecting the targets. And if you don't like these types of spectres, it's also possible to try out the more AoE focused solar guards that a lot of people like using in their setup instead. Finally, you're of course also going to want to add the relatively new Carrion Golem to your army of nasties. This golem does a pretty good job at dealing damage by itself, but the main advantage of running one of these in your setup is how effectively it is able to buff your entire army and thus greatly increasing your total damage output. The build is played as a necromancer for obvious reasons and can be played on a relative light budget, making it a great league starter to check out. Oh, and hey guys, did you know you can throw away $5 for free each month by clicking this button. Become a member on YouTube, support the channel. It works just like if you were to subscribe on Twitch for $5 a month. Thank you very much. The third build on this list is a Stormbrained Inquisitor by Theon. This is the type of build for you guys who want to go fast. Stormbrained is categorized as a brain skill, similarly to how we have totems, mines, etc. Brains, however, function uniquely in the sense that you place them on the ground and can, via the brain recall ability, drag them along with you. When they are placed on the ground, they deal damage to nearby enemies, and as long as you just make sure to run as fast as possible and drag these little guys along with you, you'll be able to deal damage to anything that comes close to your character. Dean's build is played as the Inquisitor. This allows him to effectively scale critical strike chains and critical damage, while also receiving generous buffs to both attack and cast speed. But most importantly, the Inquisitor's inevitable judgment allows critical strikes to ignore enemy elements or resistances, and thus deal the intended full amount of damage. This is especially powerful against bosses who typically have high inherent resistances. As long as the critical strike chance is high enough to reliably deliver crits, this is a very powerful ascendancy when properly utilized. Dean's belt works great right from the get-go, and due to the way you progress this character and gradually unlock the ability to place more and more brains, it feels very rewarding and fun to play this type of setup. A common criticism of the Stormbrained ability is that its single target damage isn't particularly good. Not terrible, but isn't particularly good, but I think there are two perspectives to factor in here. First of all, that really comes down to how you build it, and I've seen Theon destroy the Uber Elder on just a 5-link with his setup. Secondly, many people play this skill for the clear speed potential it offers, and typically anything that has a great focus on clear speed tends to sacrifice some power in terms of single target damage or survivability, at least when we talk about League starter builds that isn't relying on hundreds of exalts. So if this is something you are concerned about, then good on you, it means you've been researching and reading up upon Stormbrained, but in this particular case, I don't think you have reason to be worried. The only thing I'd like to add to this is that, as I mentioned earlier, we do know that bosses have been buffed in 3.9, and who knows? But then again, I guess that can be said for any skill out there. We'll see how they compare against the new changes to monster health, armor, and so forth. Coming up fourth on this week's list is Freezing Pulse Totem by Warlock. And guys, I just showcased this build a few months ago, so I'm gonna be lazy here and show you the clip, or show you a clip from that video to save myself some time so I can actually work on figuring out what build to play for myself in the meanwhile. Here it is. Freezing Pulse, first of all, is a cold-based spell that on its own deals a rather significant amount of damage. It fires out a cold-based projectile that pierces all targets. The projectile deals full damage at its cast, but then quickly fades as it travels further outwards. An interesting aspect to this is that projectile speed modifiers effectively work as a way of increasing this skill's AoE, as they allow the projectile to travel further away. Imagine you're stretching the skill, so to speak. Another benefit to this is that the point of where the Freezing Pulse projectile starts to fade is pushed out further, and the damage, or the full damage potential of the skill, can thus be applied to monsters at a greater distance. Warlock combine the Freezing Pulse skill with the Spell Totem support gem and thus effectively turn a self-cast spell into a totem that now uses the Freezing Pulse skill. He then combines this with the Hierophant Ascendancy that through the Pursuit of Justice keystone enables you to summon an additional totem, effectively doubling your potential damage output. Once you get further into the game, it is recommended you get the Soul Mantle chest armor, as through this you'll be able to ditch the Spell Totem support gem in favor of another support gem. This is because the Soul Mantle comes with an implicit Spell Totem support, which results in a 6-link effectively functioning as a 7-link. The Soul Mantle also enables the player to summon yet another totem that, when combined with Ancestral Bond, makes up for a total of 4 totems, and through this obviously adds another huge damage boost to the setup. The Soul Mantle doesn't come without its downsides though. Whenever a totem dies, you will get inflicted with a random level 20 curse, and this can of course be very detrimental in the wrong situation. However, Warlock presents a solution to that issue too. With the implementation of 2 Kikasaru rings and the Sanctum of Thought notable, curses affecting you have their entire effectiveness reduced to 0%, basically allowing you to ignore them. Even better, with the implementation of the self-flagellation unique jewel, your character will, despite them no longer exerting a negative effect on you, still benefit from up to 20% increased damage per curse affecting you. So that means that all those curses that inevitably are going to be influencing your character will, rather than being a downside, instead become a way for you to scale your damage even further. If somebody asks me which types of totem builds I recommend for the current state of the game, I always say Warchief totems, Frostbolt totems, or Freezing Pulse totems. Those three are absolutely solid, and there are many other totems that you can do, but those are a given and are definitely worth checking out if you like totem builds. The fifth and final build on this week's list is an Ice Crash Marauder build by Bashtard. So with Ice Crash, you hit stuff and it dies. That's the simple explanation. The more detailed explanation is that Ice Crash is a melee skill with a big AoE elemental component to it. It works by converting 50% of your physical damage into cold damage. When you attack, the second and third stage of the ability procs with a wall of ice protruding from the ground, dealing damage around you. And you can use it with swords, maces, scepters, axes, staves, and even unarmed, so it's a very versatile skill. Bashtard's build can be played as either the Juggernaut, allowing for some awesome survivability and AoE potential, or as the Berserker for, well, lots of extra damage at the cost of survivability. You'll be using Leap Slam as your mobility skill, and run Hatred, Herald of Purity, Blood and Saint, and Vol Haste for auras. Ice Crash is a skill that, depending on the setup, can work great as both a single target and clear skill. The unique items recommended for this build is relatively cheap, and you can practically play it with just rare gear if that's what you prefer, or until you can afford the unique items that it recommends. Ice Crash isn't a very meta-ish skill either, so if you're going for that hipster acknowledgement, then I guess it has that added benefit too. And I do, of course, have a bonus build for you guys too. It's built around the Ahn's Might, one of my favorite weapons in the game, and it is a dual-wielding Cyclone Slayer by S. Romero. No matter what happens, one thing is for certain. There will always be players who want to play Cyclone, no matter what. And it's a rather iconic skill, so I get it. And fortunately, it is a very viable skill too. This build is designed around dual-wielding the Ahn's Might Blades and then combining these with a Pacifism Duel. This together will effectively reduce your maximum amount of frenzy charges to zero, which normally isn't great, but when wielding the Ahn's Might weapon, you will receive 50% increased critical strike multiplier and up to 500 accuracy rating per weapon, as long as you have no frenzy charges. And while accuracy isn't as hard to get as it used to be, the potentially flat 1000 you receive by dual wielding two of these weapons is going to make the gear and skill tree more forgiving to progress through and allow you to pick up different nodes to further scale your damage or life. And the 100% increased critical strike multiplier is obviously very, very powerful to scale your damage. Another benefit to Ahn's Might is that it is typically very cheap and it is easily able to carry you through the entire game as long as the build is properly designed around it. As the Slayer, you will benefit from 20% more damage against bosses and an additional 10 if you have killed recently, which with the boss health buffs in 3.9 should prove to be a nice additional bonus. You also have the added benefit of being able to call any enemy at or below 20% health instantly and benefit from the overkill leech potential that the Endless Hunger Keystone provide. And that is it, ladies and gentlemen. Let me know in the comments what build you've planned out for yourself. I wish you all a great league start. I'm gonna go figure out what build to play for myself now. If you're celebrating Christmas or any of the holidays here, happy holidays. If you're interested in joining a guild in Path of Exile, check the comment I have written below. Help me out with that subscribe goal and I will be very appreciative. Thank you very much for watching, and bros, do you even nerd?